K-Lit. Relational,
uplifting,
uplifting,
motivational,
motivational. We're coming straight from the heart with this one.
Trying from the very start, she really tries to do her part. She comes straight from the heart.
Hello, everyone. I am Linda K. Lee, and welcome to Straight From The Heart. This is my newly revamped TV show. We were doing the exact same TV show in 2018, but now it is a little different. I will have co-hosts. I will be doing interviews. We will talk relationships. We will continue to keep it rum, relational, uplifting, and motivational. My husband will be my co-host when we're talking relationships and marriage. And our son will be my co-host when we're talking about our love for music. Today's episode will be a little different. They both will be my co-hosts. We will be talking about relationships today, but our relationship to what's going on with all of this racial unrest and the pandemic of racism. That's where we're going today. And although it may be a little serious and heavy at times, I promise it will stay relational, it will stay uplifting, and we will make sure that at the end of the day, you will be motivated. Before we jump into today's subject, I want to tell you a little bit about my brand new book. Damn, I forgot to love her. Hello, everyone. I am Linda K. Lee, and I wanted to talk to you about my new book, my new baby. Damn, I forgot to love her. This book is about loving and forgiving and finding yourself. Those of you that have a copy already know this, and those of you that don't, please pick up a copy. We have sold over 100 copies of this book in less than a month because people are trying to not just find themselves, but love themselves. When I first wrote the book, I was talking about the excruciating pain of finding myself, so I went, damn! But now, damn means something completely different. It means definitely appreciating me now. So not only get the book, but get one of the t-shirts as well. And not only exit out of the wrong way of loving, but let's enter and have a commencement celebration of the new way of loving others and ourselves so God can get the glory. All right, we are back, and I hope you pick up a copy of my brand new book. You can go to lindaklee.com. That is lindaklee.com, and pick up your very own copy of Damn, I Forgot to Love Her. Now, I want to introduce my co-hosts to you. I mentioned them before we went to break. To my left and your right, we have our youngest son, TJ Jamal Lee. He is the owner and the director of operations of the nonprofit organization African Unity Initiative. TJ.
Hello, everyone.
Jamal, as he likes to go by, right? And to my right, your left, is my business partner and the man I've been married to for the last 3 decades and 4, my husband, Antonio Lee.
Hi, everyone.
All right, so we're going to jump into this conversation. Here in Atlanta, as we are filming this, 2 days ago, we had some major,
It's just unrest, unfortunate events that took place, and it's so... it's almost like there's not enough time to breathe in between incidents. Mm. They just keep happening one after another, and by the time you remember the name of the one you just heard about, there's another thing happening. There's another name being hashtagged, and it was like, this has been happening throughout the existence of Black people in this country, but you know, it always seemed like at least there was some time to like reflect on the one. Like, we had the one Emmitt Till, mm-hmm. and people could like at least mourn over that.
Right.
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 And then you fast forward and you have other people, and of course you have all of the actual lynchings that were taking place.
Right.
And then you fast forward to our, you know, resurgence or resurfacing of acknowledging these events and these names. You have Sean Bell being shot outside of his bachelor party. Mm-hmm. So there was the Sean Bell period where mm-hmm. people were talking about just him. And then you fast forward to Trayvon Martin, where right. that had its own little period. But even though it was sad, there was unrest, you could at least say, okay, we were just mourning that one. Mm-hmm. And then 2014, you have Mike Brown yeah. and Ferguson happened, and Ferguson was this big moment. Mm-hmm. And then you have but then it seemed like after Ferguson, it just started ramping up, because then you had Tamir Rice, Walter Scott, Eric Garner, Alton Sterling, and so many others that around 2016, I know for me personally, it just became too much. It was like it was happening so often that there was no time to process the tragedy, no time to process the mourning, mm-hmm. the mental. Mm-hmm. Okay, what do we do? We approach. How do we respond? How do we get what we need to do? How do we organize? And then 2020.
So let's stop for a minute. Let me take it back, because he started way back. He mm-hmm. went way back. He went to Emmitt Till. Mm-hmm. So you talked about having the spaces in between to at least breathe, or to at least have a time of pullback, for lack of better terms. Let's talk about the 60s civil rights movement, mm-hmm. the mm-hmm. Latter 50s. Let's talk about like the bus boycott, mm-hmm. right? So that took almost, 18 months, something mm-hmm. in there. During that time, was that the poignant point? Was that the issue? Was that were there not other, and I know we just can't remember off the top, we don't have a book in front of us, but was that the major focus? And then they could come down a little bit before the bombings? Or were the bombings, you know, I'm trying to stay there with you about you saying.
About there being space?
Right.
So this is the thing. This is the thing about space. I'm not pretending that this is new. Mm-hmm. So the frequency of these events and as often as they happen now is just as often as they happened back then. People were being lynched daily, mm-hmm. weekly. People were gathering and having parties to watch the lynching happen. Children, mothers and fathers would bring picnic baskets to watch them not only hang this person, but set them on fire. It was an event. But the difference is, it was locally known. So news didn't spread as fast as it does now.
Right, right,
so
right.
The okay. access to knowing the name and seeing it broadcast across the internet, seeing the video of it, it creates a different mental anguish.
Okay.
Because you get to see it, right. you get to hear the names, and it's shared so widespread and so quickly.
Okay,
and
so
even still, all of them aren't even known about. Certain ones just seem to rise to the
So I'm forefront. Sure, just kind of pulling it back together here, because we went a lot of places. And you may be watching this and don't have a clue. What are they talking about? And we may feel like if you don't know what we're talking about, you've been living under a rock. That's possible. Because I know we live under a rock sometimes, depending on the situation. Could you possibly just... I want the people to know why we're talking about what we're talking about and what we're talking about. So let's kind of make it there. Let's not go too many places. Let's kind of keep it consumed so people can understand what happened. End of, what were we in? We're in June.
Yeah.
Okay, so it kind of took off with Ahmaud Arbery.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it went from there to Mr. Floyd.
No. Before Floyd... It was Ahmaud Arbery, and then I started hearing about Breonna Taylor.
Okay, so
and then Floyd came, and I was just now hearing the news about Breonna Taylor, and then I started seeing the George Floyd hashtags and like the video sharings. And
so, just in case they don't know who these people are or what we're talking about, let's do that now.
Okay.
Let's go ahead and like almost go back from the beginning. Mm-hmm. What we're talking about is our relationship. Remember, everything we do is relational. My hashtag is real relationships matter. And sometimes we feel as if we don't have a relationship with certain topics.
Right.
Okay, that's how we fall asleep. Mm-hmm. But we're talking today about our relationship that we now realize that we do have with all the racial unjust things that are going on. So if you could kind of give like a thesis statement of what we're talking, what are we talking about? If that was somebody sitting there and they're like, I don't know these names. I don't know what you're talking about. And whether they're black or white, I don't have a clue. What would be that thesis statement right now? What the topic of this particular segment is our relationship to the racial unrest.
So what we're talking about, for those who may not know, is police brutality as it
relates.
Unproportionately relates to the black community.
Mm-hmm.
Black people who... have unjustly been harmed and more so died at the hands of police officers, those people who have authority to, who are supposed to bring justice, but they are the ones that are enacting the injustice. And our struggle as black people in America with how to address it, how to really in our brains comprehend it, and what do we do from there to enact change?
Definitely.
And what is the best way to go about it? So when we mention the names, these are names of people who have unjustly died at the hands of police or people acting in the vein of police. And 2020 is its own very special
year.
Incident and year, because at the beginning of this year, everyone was excited. 2020 vision,
yeah.
Clarity.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then coronavirus came into the full fold because we had heard about it in the periphery, something that was happening in China.
Right.
And people wrote it off as something foreign because these things
don't
tend to
here.
Pop up. These things tend to pop up a lot. We
right.
had Zika, we had Ebola.
Right.
And those things were very widely spread across the news.
However,
but they pretty much stayed where they were.
Right.
They were confined in there.
Exactly.
They were epidemics. They weren't pandemics.
So go with that. So now they understand where we're going and how 2020 started out, first of all, with this coronavirus.
Right.
That had its own baby.
Its own era.
So I see the correlation with the whole pandemic verbiage related to the race relations and related to the illness, the sickness.
Mm-hmm.
But you were talking earlier before we got on camera in regards to the actual words.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I looked it up for myself because I'm very used to hearing the word epidemic. Everyone uses epidemic to describe negative things, and it's really a terminology used for disease. Mm-hmm. It's a medical terminology. An epidemic is when a disease has left its region of origin and spread to new regions. So, and most of the time it starts in like a community, and then when it spreads from that community to another, and especially when it goes national, then it's an epidemic. It's described as an epidemic. It turns into a pandemic when it leaves the country of origin and then is spread across different countries. Coronavirus is a pandemic because it started in Wuhan, China, and it spread to Italy. It's pretty much touched every populated continent on Earth, aside from Antarctica, maybe. And so
It started there.
And then what happened was we started to learn more about coronavirus and the severity of it. And it shut down so many countries in the world. Italy shut all the way down. China shut all the way down. And then it trickled here to the United States. And it shut all the way down. A lot of the cities and states mandated these quarantines where people had to stay at home to protect themselves, to protect the elderly, to protect those who were chronically ill because they were the most
vulnerable.
They were the most vulnerable, exactly. And then there was this sense of collective, we're all going through this together.
It was a weird type of unity happening.
And so that is, and I believe that has a huge element to when we get back into the police brutality and the racial injustice. And I'll make my point here.
Okay.
Because of that collective, we're all going through the same thing. As black people, we were like, okay, we get to only have to worry about this disease and not have to worry on the forefront about our blackness and protecting ourselves on that front. So we're like, okay, everybody is coming together. America is seeing us as human. We're all human moment. Because we're all being equally affected by this disease.
Black, white,
anybody.
Black, white, not only just racial, but coronavirus covered the economic stratosphere as well. So for the first time, it was almost all relative. It didn't matter where you live, what you drove, what your income level was. You were just as sick as I was sick. It was just
You were just as sick as I was sick, and you were just as financially impacted as I was most of the time. Even if you were a high-performing actor, a musician, a comedian, a athlete, your league got shut down, so you're not making money. Your concerts have been canceled. Your film production has ended. So everybody was in a place of, it was a feeling of loss, but at the same time, it was a feeling of understanding and empathy that flowed across most people's messaging when they were speaking on social media, when they were speaking publicly, whatever. And then, right at the time when we felt like, okay,
we're together.
Coronavirus is the big bad, is the big topic of 2020. Then the Ahmaud Arbery case resurfaced. Because
you told me that one. Because I thought when the film footage came out that it had happened that day. I truly thought that it had just happened. And you told me, and which that was in March.
That's when it happened.
Okay. But the footage came out in March.
The footage came out in April. It was late April, almost May.
And then you told me, do you know that that happened in February? Okay, so now we're there. So that was
So we have, so we're there. We're at Ahmaud Arbery.
And tell them what, Ahmaud Arbery, just give them a little snippet of what happened to Ahmaud, just in case they don't know.
Was a resident in Brunswick, Georgia.
Brunswick, which is right before Savannah, close to Waycross.
And Georgia. He's jogging in his neighborhood, and he just so happens to to see a housing development, a house being constructed. And as I've heard, many people do this. When they see a house being constructed in their neighborhood, they'll go up and view. I, as a black man in America, would never have done this. But my older brother, who is in the real estate,
he would have went up to the house, looked it around, turned around, wrote some stuff.
He does this. He enters vacants all the time.
Yes, that's what he does.
Snaps pictures and prepares them to see who the owner is, mm-hmm. so that he can try to sell it and flip it, mm-hmm. and that whole thing. Mm-hmm. And I've been with him sometimes, and I'm like, brother, what are you doing? And it's like, we don't know who lives around here or what they can be doing. And so Ahmaud Arbery, on a jog, mm-hmm. in his community, mm-hmm. feeling safe, mm-hmm. at home, mm-hmm. or what he perceives to be his home vicinity, mm-hmm. is not actually accosted by the police, but accosted by citizens, just regular citizens, who found him, chased him down, drove behind him as he was jogging, confronted him, created the confrontation. Ahmaud Arbery, being unarmed, is then shot once, where we hear the gunshot off camera. We see him kind of struggle to get to the other side, and then we see on full camera him being shot again. Now, this is the interesting part about the whole thing. So there was a father, there was a son. The father was an ex-police officer, and he created this fictitious story about there had been break-ins in that community, and Ahmaud Arbery fit the description. We find out later that not only was that not true, the entire scenario of recent break-ins was not true. The entire scenario was fabricated. So they chase this man down, they shoot him, and leave him dead in the street. This happens in February. These men go home and sleep that night. They aren't arrested until May. So that's something that we have to process. And then right when we're processing what's happening to Ahmaud Arbery, the hashtags are zooming over social media, the collective, okay, so we're dealing with coronavirus and we have to deal with racism. So we get punched in the face.
Yeah, that was overwhelming for a lot of
people. It was overwhelming already. And that's just the one, right? And so we have to create this storm just to get the men arrested. Mm-hmm. Just imagine. These men murdered somebody in cold blood and went home for 3 to 4 months with nothing happening. They just went back to their regular lives.
So you know what I hear? What I hear? I have, and that wasn't even by mistake, I mistakenly hit a dog while driving. Didn't want to do it, didn't mean to do it, but I went home and I slept like it was nothing. Dog got in my way or what have you. You can sleep like that when it doesn't have an...
When you don't have any empathy.
Not at all. Or that
connection.
Thing... Right.
Connection.
Or that thing that you hit, life does not compare
It's not
to
a value.
It's not a value. Mm-hmm. It's not a value. I mean, given the analogy I just used in regards to the dog, I mean, I didn't want to hit the dog. He came out of nowhere. And truth be told, I was almost more concerned about, you know, my car getting messed up, but I did not want to hit the dog. Mm-hmm. But I slept because I was like, well, you know what I said? At least he's not human. Ah, there we go. That's a whole nother show.
Right.
Because we're talking about the Constitution and three-fifths this. Okay, so then we're on the cusp of that and trying to deal mm-hmm. with that.
So we're angry about that.
Yes.
And then...
That's what we are. That's what we...
And then I start... And I have a funny relationship with these stories. And the reason that I went back at first to go over and kind of bring people up to the topic, because my relationship with these stories has changed over time. The day that Philando Castillo and Alton Sterling died on the same day in two different states in mirror situations, which was so eerie, it was just too much for me to continue to always dig into these stories and know all the details. And I consider myself a very outspoken person and a person who wants to be on the forefront of the solution mm-hmm. to these issues. Mm-hmm. But it is so heavy.
Right, right. Which is where we're coming to today.
I can't even get to it. So here we are with dealing with the Ahmaud Arbery, mourning over that,
okay.
trying to get the arrests. We get the arrests. Then the Breonna Taylor hashtag starts coming. And then...
And Breonna is the one...
Breonna Taylor is in her house sleeping.
Yeah. Right, mm-hmm. right.
The police officers have a no-knock warrant mm-hmm. of the wrong address. No one in Breonna Taylor's home is the suspect that they're looking for.
Not even Breonna.
Not Breonna. Not the, I believe it was her boyfriend, because there was a male there. And they burst in and they shoot Breonna in her bed.
Oh my God.
While she's sleeping.
Okay, 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 okay. See, okay, so let me go back to what you said before that. When you were talking about how it was getting overwhelming, you never really kind of finished that sentence. When it started to become overwhelming, let me just stop right there. I got to stop there because that became overwhelming to me. And somebody needs to cry for them, and I'm about to do it.
Right.
What do you do? And what do you think? How do you think this is the this where the show is going?
Mm-hmm.
The impact, our relationship to these mm-hmm. stories, right? So I'm gonna go. I want you to go right from Breonna. Because I, some kind of way, missed that whole piece, right? And I think I know why I missed it. Now that you were talking about the overwhelming, we keep it completely vulnerable and real here without judgment or prejudice mm-hmm. within each other.
Mm-hmm.
And when it gets overwhelming for me, one of the things I can look back now and see that I do is, if it's not... what I call, you know, if it's far away, further enough away for me not to feel it, then I guess I kind of tiptoe back in the crowd.
But honestly, that is, it's necessary to be engaged and to know what's happening.
But you can be in too deep, like Stephen Marley?
Damian Marley
said.
But if you engulf yourself in that all day and you don't take a break, you will have a mental breakdown.
Yes, and I know.
And you won't be of any good to anyone.
Anything. And that's anything. Where I found myself going, and I had to protect myself and put boundaries up for mm-hmm. me. So that happened to Ahmaud, then Breonna.
Then Breonna. And so the Breonna. And so then this is her home. So we're used to, okay, Ahmaud Arbery, there was a way for people to kind of change the narrative
right.
that maybe he was doing something wrong.
Mm-hmm. But how
there was a possible reframing of that from people who want to try to dilute the tragedy and try to make Ahmaud Arbery out to not be the victim, right?
Could
to
have
be
fabricated an aggressor. The whole story.
Exactly, which is what they did.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, but we found the truth, but also there's a level of, okay, when I leave my house as a black person, there is a sense of awareness that I have to have once I leave the protection of my home. But then you have Breonna Taylor in her home.
Right, wow. right.
So now right. we're, as black people, it's right. not even safe
there.
To be at home. Home.
To be at home.
So Breonna Taylor, and it's very necessary to go back.
Right.
Because last year, there was a young lady named Tatiana Jefferson, who also was murdered in her home by the police.
Mm.
I saw that hashtag going around, and I just couldn't dig deep into the story. I reposted it. I do these things where if it's somebody that's posting it that I trust on social media, I'll blind repost.
Okay.
Just to be involved, just so I can say mm-hmm. at least I was aware and at least I shared it to somebody in my network of people who may have not been aware. Mm-hmm. But for me personally, I cannot deep dive into it. But what Breonna Taylor did was dig up the skeletons of Tatiana Jefferson and mm-hmm. that not being rectified. Mm-hmm. And then before Tatiana Jefferson, you have Botham John, who was shot in his house eating ice cream when the white police officer, the lady, burst into his door.
Yep.
Saying she had the wrong apartment and she thought it was her apartment.
Right.
This is the lady who, when she was on trial, the judge came down and rubbed her hair.
And said, it's so
okay. The brother of both of them, John, came on the stand and said he didn't want the young lady to go to jail. This is trudging up, like every event is trudging up more. So you can't just stay in the present. It's trudging up things and emotions from the past that have been unresolved. Mm-hmm. And that lady, I can't remember, but I remember her not getting sentenced.
I don't know.
I can't remember at the moment, but I just remember the moments of a judge coming off the stand, a black woman judge.
Right.
Coming off the stand to comfort this woman who was a murderer. And sometimes we kind of gloss over our words and we say killings. We say the passing of.
No,
these aren't natural cause
passings. Right.
Murder.
Right.
This is not self-defense killing.
Right.
This is murder.
Right.
And it has to be called murder because it holds different weight in court. It's a different sentence. Mm-hmm. There's a different level of responsibility and culpability that comes with murder.
Mm-hmm.
And these people have to be held accountable for murder.
Now, let's bring them up to now.
We have Breonna. We have Ahmaud Arbery.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's a case.
And that flowed up into...
Not the police. Not being killed by the police.
Right.
Being killed by regular citizens who were able to go home. Okay. Then we kind of get some... We kind of get those people arrested and we calm down. We're like, okay, we were successful in raising enough noise to at least get them arrested. Then the Breonna Taylor, and it's just icky. And before we can even really process Breonna Taylor, George Floyd.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing about George Floyd that I believe broke the camel's back.
And it did break the camel's back.
Not only is there a history and a very recent history of these things happening, not only are we in a pandemic where people can't go outside, people are out of work, people have time on their hands, people have less to lose because they're not working. They already are struggling to take care of their families, so there is a rage that is already bubbling within people.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have a video that... George Floyd, that's different from Breonna Taylor, is it was on tape. Breonna Taylor is not on tape, so you can't really see what happened. You only have the details of the story. What's different from George Floyd and Ahmaud Arbery is that there is no way to frame it in a different way to say, oh, maybe Ahmaud Arbery attacked them first because you don't see what happened at the beginning of the video.
Right.
We see the entire video
of George Floyd
not resisting.
Right.
Of them pinning him against the
wall. And
him
asking and telling them that he couldn't breathe.
Right. But even before he was on the ground, you see him get addressed by the police. He's standing there.
Right.
They ask him to press up against the wall.
Right.
He complies. Fully compliance. Then they ask him to get on the ground. Then they proceed, three officers, one with his knee on his neck, the other one with his knee on his back, and the other one holding his arms down. And then there's another cop, watch out, looking out to make sure that nobody comes. But there are different angles, there are cameras around. So we see the entire incident. So there's no reframing of what happened.
So now we're right there. So that brings us to where I started out. And that happened in Minneapolis?
Yes.
Okay. Now we're here, right here, where we are. Now, I know this is going out to many of you are not here in the city of Atlanta. Like, we were not in Indianapolis, but we felt it as if we were.
Right.
Although we are in Georgia, when you're in Atlanta, it's kind of like your own world. Mm-hmm. Brunswick is another world.
Right.
Georgia is different
Brunswick
like
is
that.
Georgia.
Yes. Brunswick is Georgia. Atlanta, for those of us who live here, know that Atlanta is Atlanta. Now we have Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And so... 3 weeks ago, it's been about 3 weeks now since Buckhead protests, close to 3 weeks. We were protesting and coming against the racial injustice pretty much for everybody, but Mr. Floyd was our point of motivation at that time. Right.
He broke the camel's back, but in those protests, you saw people bringing up Ahmaud Arbery, yeah, Breonna Taylor,
exactly,
and George Floyd.
Exactly.
And it was just the...
And we've been protesting in Atlanta ever since. Mm-hmm. There has been a march somewhere,
yep,
ever since.
Yep.
Two nights ago. We have a young man.
There's a man...
27 years old.
In the Wendy's parking lot on University Avenue, right at University and Pryor.
Mm-hmm. Which is the heart.
We all grew up.
Went to school, so elementary. Yes.
And most of the work that I do in the Atlanta community
is done right there.
You've adopted
Pryor Road.
Right there at University,
nonprofit,
all the way down to Lakewood.
Right.
And
so it couldn't be closer to home.
Right. I'm over there all the time, literally in the community, visiting the high schools, visiting the middle schools, visiting the YMCA. So a young man is in the Wendy's parking lot and he falls asleep. And he's shot dead by the police. Now, there is video footage of the body cam where there's a scuffle. The young man, in confusion, tries to run away. In the scuffle, he grabs the taser of one of the officers. He turns back. He never uses the taser. He just grabs it from them and runs. He turns back, and then he continues to run, and they just shoot him. And this is coming after,
yes,
the mayor and the police, the former police chief now.
Because she stepped down.
Is on stage with T.I. and Killer Mike, two community
major
engaged rappers,
right,
very successful,
yes,
hip-hop artists,
right,
but who've also throughout their aging in their careers and their maturity have become very outspoken on social issues, mm-hmm, in our communities. So T.I. and Killer Mike were on stage with the mayor and the now former police chief,
mm-hmm,
and what they were doing, and they came out in response to the rioting that we in Atlanta in empathy, mm-hmm, went out to protest. And some of those protests, and I don't want to frame them as riots, they were protests,
right,
because majority of them were peaceful and majority, mm-hmm, of the people were out there, mm-hmm, peacefully.
Mm-hmm.
There were moments where there was unrest and some violence, and you know, things kind of went left. There were some people looting in Buckhead, okay, mm-hmm, and that kind of took over the people who were doing the
right,
positive protest.
Right.
And so that became the story. And so the mayor was on stage asking people to go home and trying to quell that anger.
Right, mm-hmm, right.
And then T.I. came up and he referenced Atlanta,
yes,
as like a Wakanda.
Yes.
Because it has been historically a place, as you mentioned, though it is in Georgia,
it
has always separated itself from the policies of Georgia,
yes,
and the ways that Georgia works.
Yes.
And so it's a place where black business tends to thrive,
mm-hmm,
and certain things like that, and black prosperity is more possible than it is in other places in the South.
Right.
Then Killer Mike came up, and I really resonated with what Killer Mike said because he was the first person on that podium to acknowledge why those people were angry.
Mm-hmm.
I understand and I get where T.I. was coming from and acknowledging that Atlanta, you know, has been a different place.
Right. He said it's been good to us.
It's been good to,
right,
us. But we need to acknowledge, at least let the people know we understand why,
right,
they're angry.
Right.
Why.
Right.
It's so much unrest.
Uh-huh.
Because it is... We have to value those lives. We,
mm-hmm,
say black lives matter.
Mm.
And what that means is they have value. They are worth something. So when we just tell people, and it sometimes, and I love our mayor, but for her to just get up and say, go home, is not the message that we needed at that moment.
Right.
Because not just go home, but hey, I understand where you're coming from, but there are better ways to do this, and then outline those better
ways. So here's the thing, though. Here's the thing. In her defense, because we all love mirror bottoms, but in her defense, it's like anyone else, when you are caught in something that happens like this, your whole thing is, let's just calm it down.
Right.
And then you said something about, you know, let's outline some better ways. But when they were on the stage, the stuff was actually happening. They weren't talking the next day or the hour. I mean, they were literally still in Bookhead going on. And so their thought process was, let's just calm the chill. Let's just calm the thing down. Let's just get a chill factor there. So let's just stem from that, right? I heard today, who were we listening to? We were listening to our church, Hank Stewart, the poet,
Hank Stewart, yes.
Mentioned that he goes around and he does a lot of speaking like you and talk to a lot of youth. And he said that he's been hearing from the youth that, okay, so you don't like the way we protest. Come out here and show us how.
Teach us.
Teach us. Show
and
us.
On that point.
And so I posed a question on Facebook. So baby boomers, have we failed them? I heard you say to me two things. Long before any of this started, you had to be like middle school, high school definitely. You would say to me, no offense to you, mother, but your 80s generation, y'all, with your colors and all of that, y'all just kind of went to sleep on what was happening. We came off the cusp of the civil rights movement. My generation came off the cusp of Black Panther, you know, the tail end of losing Dr. King, but we were Black Power, we had identity, and then we started getting, you know, our whole goal was like, oh, as long as I get a job, get the gold watch, and I can drive this and live here, and we've made it. And we went to sleep on them, right?
Right.
And so then I asked the question, have we failed them, baby boomers? Are we fearful, or is our focus just prosperity? Because we went through that whole prosperity gospel piece where we were not just going to church to get the word, but if the church was, you know, growing or you had these kind of dollars, that's a whole nother show. We could really get into that.
So here's what I'll say in response to that.
Yes.
And then I'll just piggyback. I'll hop on that point from T.I. So now the Wendy's burned.
The Wendy's where the guy was. You got to say
now,
that.
Where
they set it ablaze
they
last
set
night.
The Wendy's on fire.
Last
there was
night.
Unrest. People were this unrelenting. We were already still angry over George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery. And now something has brought itself to our own city where we just had these people and these powerful figures on stage telling us how much better Atlanta was. And now police brutality has come to Atlanta.
And that's what happened.
And so we have to address why the people are mad and then what we can do about it.
So let me
And
do
then when you when, I just want to address your thing about the baby boomers.
Right. Well, okay.
They had the tools. And what has happened is trauma affects people in different ways.
Okay.
So Dr. King dies. And people are angry, but he was seen as a big figurehead and a leader. And also, after his death, it wasn't just that he died. He died, people kept moving. And then Lyndon B. Johnson passed the Voters' Rights Act. And then we got the Civil Rights Bill passed. And a lot of people in that movement felt like we won.
Okay.
So we felt like it was over.
Okay, so we chilled.
And so we took our foot off the gas.
Right.
What lost that did momentum. Was set up that next generation. You guys came up under
that.
That
was us.
Thinking that we had won.
Right.
So you were in the victory years of a false victory because all it did was take a back. It went back covert.
Okay, so right there, because our time is limited, I need to ask you guys, not only because we're here in Atlanta, but you are men. And you are men who, where are you now? As far as, let me put it like this. Is it has a fear set in, and with you being a baby boomer, I'm gonna address you. Has fear set in? And with you being a baby boomer, do you attest to the fact that you did lay back? Two quick questions.
Well, first, being a black man coming up in the 60s, It was a field.
Well, we you were born in the 60s. You didn't come up in the 60s.
Well, I came up in the 70s and the 80s.
Right, more so the 80s.
We did get lax.
You got lax. I'm talking lax, specifically.
And then now that I have kids of my own,
is it fear?
I'm afraid.
Yeah,
I'm
okay. Afraid. Thank you for your honesty.
Out the street, I got grandkids, grandsons that are in panic. I'm fear for their life every day they walk outside the door.
And so here's the thing. I'm in fear for you, and I'm in fear for them. Because I'm a black woman with a black husband with black sons.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Where are you? Is there a fear that has set in? Because I know, like, last night, all I could think of was I wanted to put you and my other son, and I wanted my grandbabies, I wanted to put y'all in, like, a little, I don't know, like a little wagon or something and just cover you. I'm not lying. That's what I wanted to do last night. Where are you? Has fear set in? Has fear set in? And then where can we motivate the people?
Okay, so
that's I'll the last thing.
So here, this is where I am. I am upset. I am in a mental purgatory because I feel like I need to be doing more. I am not afraid. The only thing that curbs my aggressiveness is that I acknowledge that there are people that love me. I have a wife now. I have responsibilities. Mm-hmm. I have parents that still care about me. I have, an older brother and other loved ones who care about my safety. So in empathy and care for them, I'm not as reckless as I would want to be right now.
Okay.
I'm upset. But here's what I know is possible.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
We have fought through enslavement.
That's my thing.
We fought as Africans through colonization. We fought in the Caribbean through colonization.
Okay.
We have come through the Black Power movement, civil rights. We have people who successfully curtailed and changed policy in this country for our people. So what I'm saying is we have a playbook.
Okay.
We have the playbook of Marcus Garvey. We have the playbook mm-hmm. of Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. We have the plays of Martin Luther King. We have the plays of the Black Panthers, of us, of Encobra,
so we
of
just
all
need
these
to
different
do
organizations. So what it takes is, what I believe that we failed to do in the past is work together as much as possible.
Right. So that's the thing. That's it. We need to start working together. We need to pull the other playbooks. Right?
Pull all the plays into one playbook, and we don't have to reinvent the wheel.
That's it.
We can look at the successes of our ancestors and what they did, but pull it together and then bring it up and modernize it. And I believe there's a way forward from there.
We need to go to the polls and make our voice heard that way and know our local and state representative and get involved.
Absolutely.
And then after we vote, hold them accountable.
Yes.
Because
our
constituency goes beyond voting.
Yes.
And that's another part of those plays.
Yes.
Why we need to look and not reinvent the wheel and realize what our ancestors did right.
Right.
And then play along with that and do it.
Because here's the thing in closing. We are now getting ready to be someone's ancestors. And we want to leave the type of heritage and legacy that they left, but we want to leave them the playbook and put it in their hands. Mm-hmm. And they don't have to go searching and looking for it like we're doing right now. We want to thank you. Woo, this was good. We want to thank you. I want to thank my co-hosts, my husband Antonio Lee, our youngest son, Tony Lee, Jamal Lee. I stopped because I know he TJ. Likes Jamal. TJ. And I just want to thank you for joining us. Thank you for traveling along this road with us. And just look at it as if you've ever waited on a subway train. Here in Atlanta, we just call it MARTA. That's the name of it. Mm-hmm. And if you've ever been at the train station and you're late for work or you need to be there at a certain time and that train is not there, you find yourself constantly looking down that tunnel. As soon as you see that little light coming from that train, you're like, yes, we have got to keep looking down that tunnel. And don't allow the situations to make us not see the light at the end of the tunnel. There is hope. There is hope. I'm Linda K. Lee. This has been Straight from the Heart. I thank you for joining us. And my prayer is that it was relational. We talked about how we relate. We know you relate. You can send your comments in to us at Lee Legacy Pro Co. You can send your comments to us on my YouTube page at Linda K. Lee. On my Facebook page at Linda K. Lee. And we want you to get involved and to know that we care. We hope it was relational. We hope you that it was uplifting for you and motivational. And at the end of the day, our hashtag is Real Relationships Matter. Thank you.
Relational.
Uplifting.
Uplifting.
Motivational.
Motivational. We're coming straight from the heart with this one.
Trying from the very start. She really tries to do her part. She comes straight from